Right. Well, another daydreamy Saturday afternoon in the eternal now. And I'd like to welcome all. And express love for all beings, all shapes, all sizes, no exclusions. There are no individuals. That's fantasy. So we're going to, talk about couple of things and read a couple of things. We're doing this, as you can tell, I'm not at home. I'm in Bodega Bay in Northern California. And having a really good time. At the beaches, a lot of sitting, just quiet. Yeah, there are no individuals we've talked about. And yet, there's an insistence of what you think is your mind, or people call their mind, to say, yeah, but, you know, but. How will anything get done? There really is, but there's not. That's all nonsense being said by nobody. Nobody in particular says, I'm not so sure. It's a fact. We've been calling it, I don't know who, says I'm not so sure. But they're willing to bet the house on it. They're willing to bet everything on it. And willing to continue to suffer and feel, certainly not feel peace of any sort. I wanted to go back to this idea of mind, what we call mind. It's thought. There's no individual, so if there's no individual, who would have an individual mind? This my mind problem. My mind. Really? Where did you buy it? My house, my car, my clothes. Oh, another thing, my body. Oh, that's a good one. The same individualized concept owns everything personally, including the body, because everyone goes on, my body this, my body that. Well, who owns the body? It's an object. Are you your clothing? No. You own the clothing. It's something you gathered, apparently, this you, your car, your house, which you don't have in deep sleep. And then the fictitious mind, which isn't there either, says, oh, I was sleeping then. And there's no sequence. There is no now and then. There is no past and future, ever. Ever. It's all concept. Without thinking, without a thought, without memory, association, and perception. Who has a future? Where is the future? Have you ever seen it? Everyone's free right now. You're not in that expansiveness. That has not happened, so to speak. That has not flourished. When we look at the yin-yang sign that everyone's familiar with, that portends to the fact that everything's one substance. Awareness, we call it, consciousness, God, the only, emptiness and form are the same. That's why it's a constant flow. Where's an individual in that sign of the yin-yang sign? Where's the individual? Many want to be an individual, and that's why they are. Until they outwear its usefulness, and they say, this isn't really so much fun. And the dreaming continues, as I've said. It's not a... Well, I'll be an individual for this life dream, and then I'll be over anyway. No. Goes on and on. And yet, the one dreaming loves it, as I've been saying. When all this fiction is shed, there isn't even a reference to that person that you thought that was believed in. It's gone. And so is the world, the so-called world. The world arises and falls every moment. The throb, the spanda, heartbeat. The forms are birthed every moment by Chitta. Where are you involved? That's what it is. I just told you the facts. And my facts are completely aligned with Krishna's facts and everyone else's facts that wasn't an individual or discovered their kinship with the only. I've been saying a lot lately how to look at this as a problem to be solved is really not a good idea, because the only one that would have a problem is the one that has to go. Most see, in the beginning, see enlightenment and natural state, freedom, all the rest of it as a get. Just another get. My house, my car, my body, my clothes, my world, and my enlightenment too. That's not true. All those things will vanish because they're really not here. I know that everything, the world appears to appear real. It's not. It's empty. We were born of emptiness. We were born from a speck of emptiness that duplicated itself over and over again in magic land. By her. Where did she get that power, this consciousness, this universe that exploded out of nothing? What prompted that? No one knows or will know what prompted the absolute to have this pimple that burst, as Maharaj called it. Papaji, as I said, I don't know any yoni who doesn't, who that question doesn't have a weight to it, but it's not a burden to anyone. It's not a burden to a someone, that's gone. But it's of there's a quiet, silent interest in that. It's not a nagging, because there's no intellectual nagging and no one to be nagged. And it's more of a direct resonance with what is. When I tell everyone that when you have this, when this that you're seeking becomes yours, you know directly the original one, the only one, the absolute beingness with a capital B, or the ancient one, the one that is there whether consciousness and universe is there or not, is right now looking at this reflection of universe for its own entertainment. So that original one is first, primary, unborn, eternal, now. Not something that a problem that belongs to a fantasy has to solve to find. Now, second from that knowable unknown, knowable because it's present, it's presence itself. There's no individual present, that is. So it's knowable, but it's unknown. The consciousness, excuse me, is knowable. It's perception, it's senses, it's tactile, it's thought. No one owns that. That belongs to the original. That's the original romance. So where's the world? That's third in this expansiveness. Magically, this space, what we call the space of the universe, appears in the one light, chitta. And what we call the elements, which are empty, constantly transform in this eternal now. Right now. So where are you going to look for it? And who's going to look? Who's going to look? Your body? It's inert. When the spirit leaves the body, when the breath leaves the body, we either bury it or burn it. And it was never there. The elements remain in the fictitious, magical space of the universal consciousness. We don't know what that is. No one knows. And all these words have no meaning, too, by the way. What does it mean? Why? The one who's doing it doesn't ask that, but the one who thinks it is demands an answer. And in demanding this why and insisting that it's more fun to think about things than it is to be, suffers. and never gets an answer until it gets worn out. Many in this dream are not worn out. They're loving it, which is fine. They're not there either. It's beingness playing. It got lost. I call it the happy accident. No one can even say if that's true. One of the first things I said after transition, first month, I started to write a song called Pawn to King's Row. That's a chess term in the game of chess. If you take a pawn, if you manage to get one of your pawns all the way to the opponent's, the main row where the king and queen are, it's called King's Row. So if a pawn goes to King's Row, that pawn gains the power of the queen. Guess who's going to win that match? You got two queens now. So the analogy that I'm using here is pointing toward the imagined pawn, which is the individual, all in imagination. It's all concept. When that concept gets dissolved by the reclaiming of the absolute, which is right here now, to an open heart. When that reclaiming occurs, that pawn becomes Chitta, the queen, all powerful. And where is that queen? King's Row. Who's the king? The absolute, the looker. The supreme absolute watches this display, and it's reflected on thousands and thousands and millions of mirror-like reflections coming back to the one source of light. It watches from the space, totally free of it, and it's really not there. That's what true jnana is. No one has it. There's never been an individual, jnani or not. It's all fantasy in the mind, in God's mind. All these isms and religions, I'm not, and it's all appropriate in its own fashion and form. Right and wrong, just don't even, so arbitrary. Is it right? Is it wrong? Is it good? Or these are the things that keep this idea of mind from dissolving and finding that it has no substance, has no reality. This is what I wanted to speak about today in general, is talking, conversation. So there's no individuals, and yet we all talk to each other as though we're individuals, and no wonder it's confusing, huh? Boy, that's a bitch. We're not that, but we're, in a way, the dance is predicated on that. The world, the dance of life is predicated on the fictitious separation of the only. I'm not afraid of words. I'm that now. I'm home. So I certainly don't like to talk a lot. No one realizes preceding this how much energy is pissed away chattering about nothing. And the result of the chattering causes severe anxiety to the system, not to a person. There's no person. So it comes down in the end for each jeev, each universal ray of this universal light, who's on this Ulyssesian wandering of life dream. Each life you've dreamt as this universal one, there's no person who had a life, okay, ever. Each dream of life or person is a fiction belonging to Chitta. You don't have a memory. Nothing ever happened. So what good is it, except to make sure you don't step in front of a bus? But you don't have to think about that. That's already imprinted. So there's a tendency of conditioning of the human quality to assume that quiet, this is funny actually, in many cases, if you're quiet, it's considered impolite, standoffish, not part of the crowd. And then these fictional persons say, why is that one being quiet? So the ones that have this yearning arise, everyone here, the ones that watch this, not all the ones that watch the videos, because many watch about 5 minutes and they bolt. They're not ready. Do I care? Who are you talking about? If there's any thought that there's a somebody called Nirgun John who wants to gather things, who wants to have an enriched life dream of some kind or another, that's insanity. There's no world. Who would have it, and where would I put it? That's called projection. Well, I'm a person, so that one's a person. So back to the conversation. Feelings get hurt, the whole of it creates a play. Doesn't matter. How do we fix it? Who's there's no need to fix anything. It's not broken. Your life isn't broken. You don't have a life. Belongs to her. And her dance is for him. And they're the same. And there's an old teaching in from India. From Kashmir Shaivism, where they speak of the five taints. The five taints, I've mentioned this before. The five taints of mind, not your mind, but mind, imagined thought created mind that's yours. There's five taints that continue that confusion. And they are obsession, compulsion, attraction, aversion, and addiction. So there's no person who's obsessive. There's no person who's compulsive. obsession and compulsion belong to an aggregate of thought activity that create a person and then anoint that person as being compulsive. The idea of the person. Now we have a compulsive mind that a person owns. It's all mind stuff. There's no mind. It's thought. Why are you afraid of a thought? And the thought that I can't stop thinking is another thought belonging to no one. But if it's nurtured and it's adopted and fed constantly by this compulsive need to think more thoughts, this is what we get. The world that you see, there's no world. Nothing's gone wrong. Nothing. It's beautiful. It's exquisite. So you have obsession, compulsive thinking. It doesn't belong to a person. That's added later. So there's just this habitual thinking. Most are just by inadvertence, as Maharaj, they don't care. Or they say, oh, the person will say, I tried to be quiet and it didn't work. Okay. It's fine. I'm not going to sit there and beg anyone to be quiet. I wouldn't. Come on. But it's out of like a because it's familiar. We don't, the inadvertence is, well, what, why not try something unfamiliar? You know, everyone else wants a different vacation each year. Why not try something different in general? Take a vacation from the pain of life and discover the joy of life. How long is life? It just ended. It just started. It just ended. It just started. It just ended. It just started. That's how long it is now. What's it made of? Nothing. Stuffy stuff. Dream stuff. We're dreaming right now. Who's dreaming? She is. Who's she? That. Nature. Mother Nature's dreaming. How's that? I have some quotes from Wu Xin again. Amazing. So clear. And I'll go through a few and just let them wash over you. The thought comes, let it come and go. Just be. Excuse me. This is Wu Xin. The source of being cannot be conceived. Only objects are conceived, while the subject remains finer than mist. Wu Xin advises, stop searching for what cannot be found and instead realize one's inherent nature is that of the sought. Here's something. What is the world other than numberless mirrors reflecting the light from a single source? Many here remember the story that I retold, that Guru Mai told which is an old Indian tale, about there once was a great king, and he was a good king, and he commissioned all his architects and builders to build him a palace, and on every surface of that palace he wanted a mirror, a perfectly polished mirror, whatever surface a reflection would come back. And when it was done, he inspected it and said, I like it, it's good. And he opened it up for all to enjoy. And quickly, the dog, the raggy street dog named Popeye, Mutt, comes down the block and says, oh, palace. So he goes in, and everywhere he looks, he sees a mirror and he barks at it. And he's afraid of it, and the mirror barks back. That's people. That's your average person. And Popeye the Mutt got so upset from all the barking, he was terrified. Snake in a rope. The person sees a world that's not there and is afraid of it. So Popeye the dog, after being exhausted, runs out the front door, falls down the steps, goes down the street, goes under a shade tree, goes to sleep, and says, ah, I can't deal with this. The end of the story is a Sufi master comes by. He looks at the palace and he says, let me go in. And he walks around and says, ah, just as it should be. Everywhere I look, I see my own reflection. The person? No. There's not one person here, so-called person, who could tell me who they are. I couldn't, I'm not a person. This me, no one can define it. But out of compulsive obsessing with a compulsive mind, they're convinced of it. They're absolutely convinced. Yeah, I am so-and-so. You are, but you're not so-and-so. Then so-and-so will say, well, I'm afraid. Why would you put any value into something that you can't even produce and say, well, this is the one that's afraid, other than me again? And that same one says, well, I heard it takes a long time. So I'll wait another 10 years, or maybe another life dream. Even though I'm exhausted now, and there's only now, forever now, there'll never be a tomorrow. And that person will never have another life dream. All dreaming belongs to that. The soul universal. There's no person. This is Wu Sin again. To be nobody is to have no body. That which is prior to name and form, which one truly is, whatever it is called, whatever called, when called, it does not reply. That's why we hear it called silence. So when I suggest, why don't you dwell in your silence when you have on your free time? Well, I'm too busy. Okay, from when you get home, well, I want to watch TV. Oh, that's more important than the silence that will free you from the world of pain. Well, I don't want to miss my favorite show. What? I'm not saying what I did is better or worse or anything like that, but I can say that when awakening occurred for me, I had no computer. I had a landline telephone when everybody had flip phones. I did the due diligence, I guess, of being still. I guess it comes down to a value judgment of the confused one until it realizes, my goodness, I never was that one. And then I promise that same I got the sound on. I can't find my picture. I don't know where that.
We can see you.
You can see me? Okay. Oh, I see. There we go. I guess the Wi-Fi is, we're by the beach, so. All right, so back to Wu Sin. This is good. Recognizing the body, one is apart from the body. Right now, everyone, just look down at your knees. Just look down. Or look at your hand. It's an object. Who's the subject? The eyeballs? You see? Recognizing the body, one is apart from the body. Recognizing the mind, one is apart from the mind. Like when I always say to everyone, a thought arises in the space of awareness. What sees the thought? The awareness. Does the awareness have a name? No. Everyone can recognize immediately right now that outside of this form, that the awareness has inadvertently said, I am the body and that's the world. That's the hypnosis. There's only awareness. So we're clearing up a problem that's not a problem that doesn't belong to somebody individual. The problem is the awareness thinks that the human awareness, the human psychic instrument believes that it's an individual. So this I thought has no object. When the thought I, when you have the thought I, and there's the assumption that it's my, you're thinking about your personhood, your personage, that has no object. So who thinks I? The I am. What's that? Says the person. That's the only one here. Dreaming all the forms. A rose bush doesn't, or a pine tree, or doesn't say, oh, the other pine trees, they don't like me. It doesn't have that. It's alive, though. It's I am-ness. It's being. It's appearing in the eternal absolute only, just like any other image. The seagulls on the beach, they know they're a seagull when they're born. Without, they don't have to learn to be a seagull. And then the human watches the seagulls interact and say, oh, that one is mad at that one, is mad at that one. No, no, that's anthropomorphic. We're projecting our delusions upon creatures that don't have those delusions of thought. You know, they're just being seagulls. They don't know that they're seagulls. Their programming, their imprint is seagull. So each person, each seagull, each person, each everything is unique imprint of emptiness. One time. One manifestation. That's so safe. Okay, this is I'm going to stay with Wusen on these quotes. The background is the father to the foreground. I just said a moment ago, I said this, which looks at the display, is original, absolute beingness. From that sound, om. From that om, light. In that light space, magic, divine, it just looks. It's not involved. What you ultimately are is not involved in this. It's just watching. The background is the father to the foreground. Everything emanates from it and returns to it. Home. Now. Right now. You can be that. It was never meant to have this Ulyssesian journey. I mean, maybe it was. I don't know. These answers are so, what would that change? If I said to you, it wasn't an accident, it was intentional and it got out of hand, but whatever I said, what would it change and for who? Lacking in qualities, it cannot be described. It has no objective quality. Nirgun. Or Nirguna. That's your true nature. You don't have these qualities. And you know that you don't have them because every night, so-called night, and there isn't one night after another night after another night. There's only now. Last night, now. The night before, no, always now. So the shift goes from dream to no dream. Dream, oh, I'm tired, no dream. Your natural state is so much more akin to the sleep state, but then this thief of mental construction says I go to sleep and I didn't sleep well last night. And I don't believe that, what you just said. Suit yourself. Then you don't believe Krishna, you don't believe Maharaj. I can go right down the list of others that you would believe that never existed. This is funny. Trying to understand oneness is as futile as trying to drink with the ears. And it's this insistence of I, me, want to know. And I know I'll know. No, just give it up. Just let it all go right now. That same song I was talking about, Pawn to King's Row, there's a line that I added at the end of that. It's okay to let it all blow away. Well, what do you mean? What part? All of it. That's when the magic really starts. That's when the fun begins. And everybody likes fun. The one human constant is we like fun because life is supposed to be fun. It is fun. Who said it's not? Me. Who's that? I don't know. Right? All right. There is no body to have a body. That which is prior to name and form is what one truly is. You don't have a body in deep sleep. Whatever it is called, when called, it does not reply. I've always said the absolute isn't saying anything. So when that absolute accepts the one who's not recalcitrant, who's not stamping its foot, who's not demanding an answer, who's not throwing a tantrum of mind that doesn't exist, then that grace moves forward. Why should it respond to a child's tantrum? That's not there. And that child wouldn't know what to do with it anyway. And I'm talking about adult childs now. The adult ones. With all their ideas. Permanency is the primary misconception. Everything comes and goes. When this is fully comprehended, clinging ceases. The joy for each thing is magnified. Again, the fun, the real, the Raj, the Raja, the Raza, the things of life, the sweetness of life. Then one can really love. One what? One imprint of that. And when that imprint, that diamond-like imprint, is in natural state, there are no questions. None. Deep silence. And from there, one can actually have what I would call a conversation. But I'll be very circumspect about how broad that conversation should be. And quite frankly, on the finer levels of communication, not the, this is Vaikara. Right now you're hearing an explosion of sound out of an imagined mouth in a holographic presentation. Below that, they have the Madhyama, which we know as thought. It's all the same primary functioning of what we call speech, the principle that talks. People don't talk. The principle talks. That principle has four iterations. The Vaikari, explosion, Madhyama, which is thinking. Below that, Prashanti, which is kind of like a wave-likeness, which if you're willing to spend time to be quiet, you can find these things. They're there. You can sense them, find them. And then below that is the Paravina, which is very incipient. That's where everything comes up from. We have four bodies that correspond to these levels of talk making. Krishna said, I am prior to the Paravina. Why? Because that's what this is. What you are is prior to the Paravina. I watch that incipient rising. Everything's floating. I don't see solid anything. Right now, the table's like this. The ceiling's doing its little, you know, I call it its little hula dance. You're going to take that for real? And then the person goes, I don't know, that sounds scary. Because they're so used to a world that they're actually, they prefer the misery. The fear, misery, anxiety, they prefer it. It's known. Who knows it? I don't know. But it seems familiar. You have to break out of what seems familiar and to have value, which is assigned by thought. There's no meaning, there's no message. By dwelling in that, all reveals. This convention, this societal convention of persons, non-existent. Society is a group of non-existent persons with laws and convention. Well, we like it that way. Some conventions are nice. It's the holiday season. There's nothing wrong with being human, but find out what a human is. And when that voice says, I don't know if I can do it, laugh at it. That's your homework. Talk to that thinking Mariam and say, what kind of crap is this? And watch how quiet it gets until you are inadvertent again. Then it'll start yammering. Now, please don't ask me why it does that. Because you feed it, actually, because it's well fed. It's like anything else. It comes back for more. And inadvertently, most persons feed this machine, this non-existent Madhyama, like it's the Holy Grail. And then they have to look for a way to get rid of the Holy Grail that they've accepted as a nobody. When all I have to do is recognize that nobody had it. That's the direct route. If you want, you can join an ashram for last years of your life and believe that the next time you will deserve it. You haven't done due penance yet. There's another concept. If there's no person, who needs to do penance? Who needs to improve? It's already perfect. Let's see. One becomes one's thoughts when one claims ownership of them. When they are merely noticed but not attended to, they can do no harm. So if thoughts arise, really not, but when they do, it's just thought. I'm not that. It's a function. Thought is a function. It's a very good servant. What we call mind and intellect is very powerful and very useful. It's a horrible master. What we have today in the imaginary world is an explosion of intellect and technology and a diminishing of wisdom. You know? Right? With the iPhone, that'll set you free. I lost my iPhone. Oh. You want to watch a nervous breakdown in action? My whole life is on that phone, says nobody. I'm going to jump off a building. I lost my phone. Says the thoughts. There's no building to jump off of either. But we got to fix that. No, we don't. No, we don't. I wouldn't play with it, though. I'd have the courage to put it down. It is easy to be lost in imagination. Much more difficult it is to be rooted in what is. Yeah. Forsaking the former requires the willingness to see a world different from the one that you planned. Everyone here is at that point. That willingness has come and it's knocking. It's knocking at the door, the open door. It's saying, do things different. Try this. All right. Okay, skip that one. I'll read one more too. These are really good, all around, really good pointers. You might even want to get a book by him. The silence of which Wu Sin speaks is beyond the presence or absence of thought. It is prior to both, prior to the Paravena. And it is their foundation. When one perceives what is not silent, the perception is from this silence, the face of the ancient one. It has no distinguishing features. It's vast. Okay.